the love of Jesus. Everybody sing in the name that's above every name. How many know there's peace in it? Joy in the name. Happiness. Power. Healing. Blessing. Glory. All that we need. Lift your hands and say, all that I need. He's in the name. And he has given me authority to use the name. Thank you, Lord, for your name. Your name is great. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Amen. All right. All right, anybody want to dance in the spirit before we start? I said, no thanks. It's a blessing. No thanks. All right. Well, we thank God for all of you tonight. I just want to admonish you to continue in the lessons that we have had in the past. I think the first lesson we did with this handout was speak out God's word. Amen. Speak out God's word. We're trying to get God's people to open their mouth. Tell somebody to get to a table. Amen. The Lord wants us to open our mouth. God doesn't want secrets and servants. He wants servants that's willing to obey him. Yeah. Amen. With you. The second part of this, praise God for what you're believing for. If you don't have this little handout, just raise your hand. If you didn't bring it with you, raise your hand. All right, somebody can ask these. Praise God for what you're waiting for. Amen. Okay. Last week we focused on related to you stories and which illustrates the points that we're trying to make, because all of these scriptures that falls under this category, they are based.
Have more.
Thanks, sorry.
You have any more handout?
Yes.
Oh, okay. Never mind.
I got some more here.
Thank you.
All right, I had to be run off. I usually try to get two or three sets because I know.
Thank you, Pastor. Thank you.
All right, you ready to go, Brother Ron?
I'm ready. Ready,
Rich? Okay, all right. Okay, Brother Wayne, I'm going to ask you, not right now, but at some point, we're going to recap stories that illustrate the points that we're trying to make in this particular unit. Last week, we talked about Jehoshaphat and how they used the art of worship. The worship is a powerful element. It's a powerful component. Now, we saw that in Jehoshaphat's victory, there were several things involved. Amen. There were several factors involved in Jehoshaphat's victory over those nations that came against them. We're going to point those out in a few minutes. Also, we mentioned Jonah in the belly of the whale. So, in that particular instance, certain factors that led to Jonah's release and Jonah's victory in terms of being in bondage and captivity. He was doomed to death, it seems, but God came through. We want to know exactly what he did in order to get the victory that he received, okay? Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead. That also illustrates what we're speaking about, how Jesus offered thanks. Amen. He didn't even pray. He just said, Father, I thank you that you've already heard me. Amen. In other words, you already had God's word. And that's the thing about today. We already have God's word for almost everything, every promise. We already have it, right?
Right.
And if you respond and give God thanks, you know, amen, you can just be as bold as Jesus. Father, I thank you that you've already what? You've already heard. Amen. The scripture says that this is the confidence that we have in him, that we shall ask anything according to his will. He does what?
Hear.
God always hears us when we ask anything according to his will. When we do it in faith, he always what? Hears us. All right, so Jesus said that, Father, I thank you, you've already heard me. Amen. Praise God. Okay, now we have Paul and Silas in prison. That's another good illustration how they use the power of praise. We can call it thanksgiving. We can call it the sacrifice of thanksgiving. We can call it worshiping. We can call it ministering to the Lord. But all of these things are basically the same thing that God really wants us to engage in order to receive the things that he has promised us. You know, God can't do nothing for us until we ask him or we thank him. We got to express it in some form of prayer. God can't do anything unless we petition him or ask him to do it. Amen. So Paul and Silas is a perfect illustration. And Monday night, Brother Wayne, he just wove the illustration about the Canaanite woman, is that right?
Yes, amen.
That came to Jesus, that Jesus told her no.
Yes, yes.
And the woman got down and worshiped the Lord.
Yes, amen.
And she left receiving what she wanted. Brother Wayne is going to give us a recap on that in a few minutes. All right, then there are some other illustrations that we read about in the Bible. Today I was reading about the 10 lepers. Anybody can recap that? The 10 lepers that Jesus told to go to show themselves to the what?
Priest.
Priest. And how many remember that story? All right, anybody remember what happened when they were sent?
They all went and showed themselves, but it was only one that gave him thanks.
All right.
The others just went away.
All right. So when they realized that they had been healed, they went and showed themselves to the priest. Did they get there? I guess they did. But when they returned, they recognized that they were healed. And one of them did something very spectacular. Amen. Nine of them just what? Kept going, they didn't say a thing. Did he even say thanks? Just like Pastor Neil preaches every Sunday. Very rarely you'll say, Pastor, thank you. Appreciate the word. Amen. Not quiet, good, isn't it?
Thank you, Pastor. Appreciate that word.
When we do things in the church, sometimes the thank yous are very, very what, scarce. So for Dorothy, saying, great is thy faithfulness.
Tear up the place.
I mean, we tear up the place, we cry, we weep, we reach over, we get out of a breakthrough, get broken.
Nobody gives me an offer.
Amen. We just get up and walk out. Amen. Just get up and walk out. We don't sit. Had a good service. Praise the Lord, Sister Dorothy. Praise the Lord, Praise Steve. Praise the Lord, Pastor. Now, some people do. Some people actually do that. But we don't have enough people that are thankful enough for the things that they receive. I'll put it that way. How's that?
Don't you think it's because a lot of times people are just not thoughtful? It's not just the church people. Sometimes when you're in the supermarket, shopping or whatever, you have some salespeople that say, when you buy something, they'll say, thank you. In other words, thank you for your business. And others will shove your merchandise towards you. They don't say anything like, get out of the way. I got next person coming up here. I just think that there may be it's a cultural kind of thing that sometimes we don't mean anything. People don't mean it. They just not thoughtful, maybe.
Sometimes we might even talk to each other about how good the service is. Or we can brag, we see somebody else about how good our pastor is, a preacher, teacher. That's what I always call you. But I guess we just don't think. We need to remind ourselves to speak it to you also.
Okay. And speak to each other.
That's a good point, because very seldom I ever hear our people out north when they're at the cash register checking you out. Very rarely do they ever say
that.
Is that right, Brother Williams? You notice that? Now, most times, the other people, they say, thank you, come back, and they have a lot of nice things to say. But sometimes we're just very slow in that particular area. So we want to change that around. And we just want to cultivate a rich sense of thanksgiving. I think this is the thing that God wants us to do. The Bible mentions about how important thanksgiving is to God. You know, so I want you to be thinking about all of those instances in which we see in the Bible where people gave thanks and it seems like their blessings were overwhelming. The man that turned around and told the Lord, thank you for healing me of leprosy. This man, the Bible says, he went away and he was made whole. The others, they didn't even show up. He just kept going. When they saw they were healed, he just kept going. But one man turned around and came back and said, Lord, amen. And the Bible says he worshiped the Lord with a loud voice. And he said, Lord, thank you. The Bible says very plainly that he was made whole. Amen. I don't know what all was involved in being made whole, but it seems like he got a lot more than the others got. Okay, let me see if I can find that incident. Luke 17 or 18, I selected today.
All right, 17 and 11.
Okay, let's look at 17 and 11. Read this, Sister Hill, the whole story.
Mm-hmm. And it came to pass, as he went to Jerusalem, that he passed through the midst of Samaria and Galilee. And as he entered into a certain village, there met him 10 men that were lepers, which stood afar off. And they lifted up their voices and said, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. And when he saw them, he said unto them, go show yourselves unto the priest. And it came to pass that as they went, they were cleansed. And one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back and with a loud voice glorified God and fell down on his face at his feet, given him thanks. And he was a Samaritan. And Jesus answering said, were there not 10 cleansed? But where are the 9? There are not found that return to give glory to God, said the stranger.
Okay, continue.
And he said unto him, arise, go thy way, thy faith made thee whole.
Okay, Brother Rod Dennis, read verse 15 again, Brother Rod Dennis.
And one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back and with a loud voice, glorified God.
All right, so I want you to just show the people probably how this man sounded.
Oh, you want me to put my acting skills to you? He said, thank you, Lord! Thank you, Lord! Thank you, Jesus! I probably did something like that.
Brother Todd, Can anybody outstrip him? Can anybody do it a little louder?
Anybody, what now?
All right. Okay, that was a very powerful story, that how that man turned around, and when he saw that he was healed, he came back and he gave thanks. Okay, so y'all can see the importance of giving thanks to God, because the other man, they didn't have all that they needed. They weren't made whole like this man that turned around. But at least they were healed, and as they went, you know, they were cleansed. At least they were healed, so they were blessed. Now, the man that was made whole, can you kind of visualize what he received that the others didn't receive? Can anybody just kind of surmise or visualize as to maybe what he got that the others didn't get?
All were physically healed. But the one that was made whole, you said surmise. Mm-hmm. I'll surmise that emotionally he was whole, and every with us. Spiritually, he was whole. The others were physically, but it didn't, well, it doesn't indicate, but just surmising that his healing was total. Mm-hmm. The total man. Physically, emotionally, spiritually.
Whatever kind of problem he had, whatever hang up, whatever burdens he was carrying, whatever he's been dealing with, all of his emotional problems, all right.
He laid it at the feet of Jesus.
Amen. Okay, so that was the difference in the nine and the one. Okay. Okay, now, on page 24, praise God for what you're believing for. Psalms 46, let's all read that together. It says, let all of those that do what?
Seek me, rejoice, and be glad in me. Let such as love thy salvation say continually, the Lord will be magnified.
All right, it says, let all of those that what? Seek thee. Okay, now, what does that mean? Let all of those that seek thee rejoice. There are all of those that seek thee. So there are some criteria that has to be met in order for us to receive from God. And he tells us very plainly, everyone that seeks the Lord, they need to do certain things. All right, what did he say they need to do?
Rejoice, be glad.
All right, be glad in thee. All right, let such as love thy salvation say continually, the Lord be what?
Amen.
All right, so rejoicing is the prerequisite. You know, the scripture that we read all the time, let's turn to Philippians 4. It says, be careful for nothing. I believe that's the right scripture. That's Philippians 4. Let's all read it together. Philippians 4.
4, 6.
Okay, let's all read it together. Philippians 4, 6.
Be careful.
Okay, everybody say what?
Be careful for nothing. Mm-hmm. In every meeting, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God.
Okay. Be careful for nothing. What does that mean, be careful for nothing?
Worry, don't be worried about it.
All right, don't be full of what? Anxiety, fear, afraid. But in everything, by what? All right, somebody tell me what supplication means. Okay, it's an earnest what? Entreaty or request that we direct to God. The Bible says that the effectual fervent prayer of the righteous man does what? Okay, that supplication is our earnest. He is our rewarder of those that will what?
Diligently seek him.
Okay, supplication is a prayer, a very intense prayer. Very intense. So people that pray these feeble prayers, these weak prayers, the prayers that they don't put themselves in it. Scripture says very plainly, the sacrifices of God are a broken spirit. And I think that it's the intensity of the prayer that gets the result. It's the sincerity of it. It's the earnestness of the prayer, of the petition, that really brings the answer back. Okay, so we don't want to pray no weak, feeble prayers because it won't go no further than the ceiling. But earnest prayers, Bible says the kingdom of heaven suffered what? Violence, but the what? Violent will take it by what? Force. So how many understand how to pray until there's a brokenness? What do you do until you get past the flesh realm and get into the realm where you are really releasing your spirit or your soul in earnestness? At what point do you have to get in order for you to get into a realm where your prayers become effectual? So I would say a point of brokenness, when you begin to release yourself to the point where it's no more you, the spirit just what kicks in, and the prayer gets out of your control and into what? God's control. And usually that's a point of brokenness. And usually that's a point when you extend. I think Miles Monroe, years ago, he was describing how a person goes from level 1 to level 7 in worship. And he says that as you begin to progress in worship, usually when you start out in worship, most times you don't feel like it. You know, you don't really put anything in it. Is that right? The first level is that you're trying to unite. I hope y'all can understand what I'm saying. Unite your spirit, soul, and body. That's one of the main reasons why many times we don't get into the flow of worship, because it's very difficult to unite spirit, soul, and body together. And when they unite and begin to flow together, then that's the thing that ushers us into worship. Now, your physical body many times is tired. Amen. I may can say after a day's work, if you rip and run, if you have a lot of things to do, a lot of commitments, many times you are expended physically. You're tired. And many times people just don't what? They say, well, I'm tired. I'm not going to deal with it, you know. I'm just going to what? Get all I can, you know, and, you know, I'm not going to overrule or override my, what, tiredness. I'm just going to, what, just kind of ride the tide, you know. If somebody else praising the Lord, I'm just going to ride the tide. I'll tap in on that. Amen. So, a lot of times, the saints tap in on the anointing after somebody has, what, really persevered and scream and holler and amen and praise the Lord as loud as they can and pray in the spirit, and they tap in on the what? On the anointing. You know, I don't have no problem with that. You know, I don't have no problem with it. Somebody's too lazy to pay the price. I want them to get all they can. Paying all they can get. Alright, but there's a price normally somebody has to pay. Even on Monday nights when we come, if everybody just sat here and just gave in to their feelings and wouldn't persevere, wouldn't raise their voice, wouldn't pray in the spirit, wouldn't lift your voice, Sometimes it seems like ain't nothing happening sometimes in traveling. I mean, it seems like you can't get nothing happening. And then, but you realize that most times when you feel, you can't feel the spirit moving, you seem like nobody got it tonight. I've been in prayer meetings, it's like nobody. Usually somebody's on fire, and usually if you get one or two on fire, that can almost bring everybody in. But when nobody is on fire, everybody's tired, everybody's giving in to their tiredness, sometimes it just be dry. And it's going to stay dry until somebody, what, lift the voice and persevere. And if you can't get in one way, you know, some people say, you know, thank you, Jesus, sometimes won't get you in. Sometimes people, you know, say, see the bow tie fly? They can't get in that way. That tongue, you know, sometimes we learn our tongues, and sometimes, you know, that won't get us in. All right? Then, but sometimes, I think that we ought to be very open, and we ought to be observant to how the Spirit is moving now. That more of you are singing in the Spirit to some degree. Many of you are beginning to sing in the Spirit. And when I first started, my first several years, it took me a while to get into the flow of prayer. And in those days, we had, you know, saints that most of them were people that really prayed and they fasted and they really, you know, came together. And the church where I went, they did a whole lot of things in prayer. Sometimes when things were kind of cold, to get the spirit, soul, and mind united in prayer, they were saying little praises. It was, my soul love Jesus. Now, some of y'all don't know nothing about it. My soul love Jesus. You know, all of them would be saying that. My soul, I mean, they would just, everybody come to the prayer meeting dead. I mean, they tired, they drained, they don't feel like it. They had a hard day. And then you just don't walk into the anointing that easy. So they would do things that would bring people into the anointing. He said, my soul love Jesus. Bless his name. He's a wonder in my soul. He's a wonder in my soul. They do that over and over for about 10 minutes. And after a while, the thing break loose. And boy, those old mothers could sing them some. And after the thing broke loose, man, stuff start happening. Some of us would say, hey! Hallelujah! They would begin to shabbat. So what I'm saying is that there are certain things you can do to unite your spirit and soul to bring you into worship, and you can begin to flow in the Holy Ghost real easy. And one thing that God has ordained for us to do is to usually we start our praise and worship off with singing. With singing. Singing is a good way to unite spirit, soul, and body. See, your mind is wandering. Most times people's minds don't be focused enough in order to be, don't be focused well enough. Your mind is floating around on what you did today, what you got to do tomorrow, what happened to you today, what you're going through, what you're dealing with. You know, there's a whole lot that we could reflect on when we get in prayer meetings. But you got to find a way to get everything out of your mind that you're thinking about that's going to hinder you from getting into the flow, because your life really depends on you uniting, I mean, your spiritual growth to a great extent, your breakthrough, the answer to your prayer, to a great extent, depends on whether you're able to overrule the body, the physical body, because the body is not going to want to cooperate. Amen. Monday night when I came, everybody was up at the table praising the Lord, and I was tempted to get in that chair where Brother Wayne was. That's the most comfortable chair in the house. But I went over there and got on one of these old blue chairs. Because I knew if I got in that chair, amen, I would have what? I would have gotten very comfortable. So I got in a hard chair, and I began to what? Deal with my prayers. Okay. So your mind is not on praising the Lord because you are dealt with so many issues and gone through so many changes, so many pressures, so many cares, so many things you've done. Your mind is just here and there. It doesn't really have a mind to what? Praise the Lord. And your spirit deep down within, really, that's the reason why you came here. Your spirit is what? Hungry. And your spirit wants to what? Wants to get with it. How many ever heard, my spirit's willing, but my flesh is weak? Alright, so your spirit, more than likely, if you're a spiritual-minded person, your spirit really is hungry, really desiring, really is reaching out to worship and to magnify the Lord. But your body is hindering you, and your mind is what? Preventing the spirit also from what? Being released. So what do? You sing. And that's the reason why those mothers, they sing the Lord's praises. Thank God for Jesus. Thank God for Jesus. They had about 8 or 10 or 12 little phrases that was, they go from one to the other. And when they go from 1 to 10, brother, amen, you better look out. You better look out. Okay. So, once your spirit and soul and body really unite in praise, then there's no more hindrance, there's no more obstacles that's standing in the way that's going to hinder you from getting your breakthrough. You got to unite your mind, your body, and your spirit. So the best way that most people do it is through singing. Sometimes people can do it through praying in the spirit. Everybody can't pray in the spirit initially. Amen. That's it. 7 o'clock we start praying. Let's all begin to pray in the spirit. Some of y'all said, just like that? I can't pray in the spirit right away. It's going to take me about 15 or 20 minutes. I got to do some scripture reading. I got to, you know, be in the flow of it for a while, and then the tongues will come. All right. Okay, but what happens is that praying in the spirit is very effective if you have practiced your, if you practice your prayer language a lot. More than likely, you could flow immediately when you get here at 7 o'clock. And if you can pray in the Spirit, it's probably one of the best ways to do it, to get into the flow. Because once you get into the flow of it, and if you put a little bit more into it, you pray in the Spirit. But the problem with praying in the Spirit sometimes is that we have done it a certain way, and we have a habit of saying the same thing in the Spirit, and we do that. And usually we don't go any further than what we are kind of used to. Am I right? All right, now to get past that, you got to what? Raise your voice. You got to what? Put a little bit more into it, right? And I don't see anything wrong with shouting loud. You won't scare me. And I think that is a hindrance, because I think that to some people it seems a little unseemly. It's out of character. That's not me. Suppose that leper would have said, that's not me, to open my mouth and shout loud. He probably wouldn't have gotten what? His wholeness that he received. So, now, I hope y'all are getting the scriptures. Scripture after scripture is admonishing us at some point as we seek God. We got to what? We got to expend a little bit more energy. And we got to become a little bit more intense. We got to raise our voices. We got to put a little bit more into it in order for us to what? Come up to a level where God can do more. How many want God to do more than what he is doing or what he has done? But if you want God to do more, then you have to what? You have to release more, and you have to what? You have to open up your heart more. And a good way to do it is to raise your voice. Now, Brother Williams, I mean, he reminds us, let the voice of your praise be heard. Let the voice of your praise be what?
Heard.
Okay, now, when I had a real hard time getting a breakthrough in food in the Spirit, I usually would come up to the church and I would practice praising God as loud as I could for about 10 minutes. I would come up here and just howl as loud as I could for about 10 minutes. And when I did that, I got beyond the block. I got used to opening my mouth wide. Because when you open your mouth wide, see, Shabbat praise is a praise. Once your spirit and soul and body really begins to unite, then there is a level of praise in which you need to dance or you need to say something loud in order to get beyond the realm that you are. See, the first realm is the struggle realm. The second realm is when things begin to get easy. The third realm of praise is the time that we need to do some physical movement or we need to shout and say things loud. That's Shabbat. And this scripture, it says here, let me see which one talks about saying something loud. How many remember Jehoshaphat? I believe, let's turn back to there. We'll see that they practiced that last week. 2 Chronicles 20. Okay, what I'm doing, Saints, tonight, I think that we are very close to a breakthrough. Now, I really want us to get a breakthrough in singing in the Spirit. And that is going to be in the realm of Tehillah praise. Singing spiritual songs spontaneously. There's a few more things that we got to do in order for us to flow in that. Okay, so 22. Okay, it says here, 18, and Jehoshaphat bowed his head with his face to the ground, and all Judah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem fell before the Lord, worshiping the Lord. They fell before the Lord, worshiping the Lord. Okay, and the Levites of the children of the Kohathites and of the children of the Kohathites stood up to praise the Lord of Israel, the Lord God of Israel, with a loud voice on what?
High.
Loud voice. So it's got, that loud voice is a level of praise that takes you to another level where the supernatural can kick in and you can continue to ascend to the level of worship that God will come down and fully release those blessings that He wants to release into the environment where people are worshiping. See, when we pray in the Spirit, that's just level two. We ain't near about there. All right, Pastor. We ain't nobody. Now, if you're fortunate enough to be able to pray in the Spirit, you are a long ways away from being at the level where God comes down and manifests Himself in the congregation. Praying in the Spirit is good. Everybody says it's good. It's good. So you can see how far we are missing it when we just refuse to pray in the Spirit. I mean, sometimes we act like it's an option. Y'all looking at me strange now. Bible says, be filled. It says what? Stay filled. And I don't know of any way that you can stay filled without what? Singing those hymns and songs and melodies and all of those things that we are admonished to do in Ephesians 5, 17 and 18. It says, be filled with the Spirit. Don't be drunk with wine. but be what? Filled, stay filled with the Spirit. Now, how did the disciples in the book of Acts, how did they pray? Paul said, I pray in tongues more than any of y'all. Acts 4, they were all there. They prayed until the place where they were assembled shook. And everybody, the Bible says, all of them were what? Filled or refilled with the Holy Spirit. So, it's very serious, saints, that we get this message and understand that praying in the Spirit is important, but praying in the Spirit is only level 2. That's the point in which your spirit, soul, and body actually comes together and the ability to pray becomes easy. You get your release. You can really begin to navigate in the Spirit once you get to the level where you are fluent in the Spirit. Okay, now here's the thing, that when you begin to flow in the Spirit, you just don't say, you don't just do that all the time. I mean, why not? You got to get more and more. You got to put more into that. Because you can just say, you can do that, and you can do that every time, and it's just going to be about the same, thing from that point on. Put something in, whatever. If you get a little breakthrough, put a little bit more into it. Amen. Sister Hill, since it's diarrhea, all the know Sister Hill is there. Sometimes we don't even know whether anybody is saying about it. We can't even tell. Everybody is so soft.
Pastor, you've been talking about praising with a loud voice, Thanksgiving with a loud voice. I was just thinking, what does loudness do? Okay, I think that what it does, it creates an excitement when you're loud. I don't know of a better analogy than to draw like a football game. You know, when you have two teams that are playing and there are, at the end, maybe a basketball game, the score is almost tied. And you have one of a section of people in the bleachers, and they're just, making all kind of noise. And it creates an excitement. And I suspect it does something for those players out there, that's playing. But here, there, those people supporting them, cheering them on. So what I was thinking about is that a loud, not just being loud to be loud, but a loudness helps to create excitement and a solidarity among the group.
Okay, let's open that up. How everybody else feel?
Ask Judy.
Okay, Judy. What does loudness do? When you open up, what does that do?
Is this not an exercise in futility? Oh, okay.
All right.
I'm finished.
It's got to be something to it.
When you're expressing yourself out loud, say something like that football game, when the home team or the opposing team and their fans beating and cheering and beating on buckets and drums, and all of that, that team gets charged up.
Yeah,
they come out, they think, okay, we're with them, we can do this.
Okay.
I'm thinking, now, when you're in church, if you're loud, then if people come in, they loud. Let's get into something going on. That loudness, it charges the...
It charges the people. Now, what about the person that's doing it? Does it charge them too?
Oh, yeah.
All right.
You're saying it's contagious.
Yeah.
All right, Brother Beauty said... Okay,
I believe the anointing can follow from one person to the other. Mm-hmm. Just like when you were speaking about old mothers back in the day. Mm-hmm. I remember the first time I really felt that anointing. and that's what was happening. They were singing songs. And after a while, I just started shaking, and I felt it. I mean, that was my first experience, and it was just like you said. They had just kept on singing songs, and after a while, that power just fell on you. Yeah. And I mean, if something was wrong to me if you didn't move or say something. So.
Did they ever get loud?
Yeah, they got loud. The women were screaming and hollering. And everything, you could just feel it, even in their voices, you could feel the anointing. It was just different.
I think it goes back to what you said about our minds wandering and your tongue. When you soon line up your mind with purpose, for what you're there for. Okay, so now you're here, you really are here to praise the Lord. It's not form and fashion.
Right.
But when you get, and that's what the purpose of where you are in the service. Then if you apply yourself,
right.
Then you get the benefit of it, and you line your thought processing when you say, Lord, I thank you, and then you get to thinking about what he has done, and you look back, or you're going through something that I even made it, or here today, or whatever. So once you get your mind lined up with what's going on, there is that excitement that, oh my God, how awesome he is, and you can get involved in the service, or you can make it. Get involved in your praise. You keep going and you hear somebody over here, all right, and so when you understand that it is the combination of all of it.
Right.
That's good. That God's
moving. It's something about that shout, that loud thing.
Okay.
Y'all brother Ron, he won't let me speak. He's like, but him lifting his voice, even when he comes to prayer, wherever he is, it just resonates. It just inspires me. It blesses me.
I was going to say that not only by that individual person being loud, that also gives the freedom to the people around them. To sort of open up as well too, not be so fearful of doing exactly that.
Wow! All right. Okay, Sister Dawn.
What does the loud do for Jesus? Mm-hmm. What does the loud do for Jesus?
All right, that's what Sister Dawn said. What does the loud do for Jesus?
Well. Rejoices
in it. Yeah, let's look back at the 10 lepers.
Brother Wayne talked about that. But
well, the 10 lepers kind of illustrates that.
Uh-huh.
Okay, one turned back and glorified God with a loud voice. It doesn't say exactly what he did, But then it prompted, I'm surmising, it prompted him to say, hey, where are the other nine? How can I say?
All right, Brother Wayne. Okay, Brother Wayne, you keep talking about that money back.
Yeah, right.
Okay, so that.
What does it
mean? So, Lord asked the question, what did that loudness, open your mouth wide, like a leper, or like the worshiping woman of the night, like the leper tonight? What does that do? You might have to get up. You look too comfortable. I wanted to be as powerful as it was Monday night, so I don't want to.
You got to be captive to certain things. Camera and whatnot, but. I think it gets his attention. It's just like, like a crowded room, like a example I gave Monday night, even like sometimes you see a press release from the president, and how some of the reporters be trying to ask questions on certain things. And it just seemed like the one that's able to elevate the voice above the other, that's the one that got the attention. And got them, got their questions answered. And it just, I can only imagine in my mind that many people across the world petition God for things. And, constantly, you got people over there maybe in Ethiopia with dire needs. You got other people, probably now over here in this country, regarding our economy, regarding the drought, addressing and praying for God to come in and rescue. But then sometimes we, in our own personal life, we, I guess we associate it with what the scripture say, God knows what my need is. And we try to use our mind to petition him and be quiet and not really, you know, as you know, recognize that you have a serious need and get God's attention just as bad as they have a need. And so it's just like, I think I was reading the scripture about Zacchaeus and how he was able to elevate himself. He got up in the sycamore tree. And sometimes you're to climb above the rest of the others of the crowd that you're around and whatever's all going on to get Jesus' attention. That's where you get God's attention regarding your situation, to address it. And when you sense a sincere need, you ain't going to be passive about it.
That's right.
Amen. I mean, as the Spirit began to move in the church on the Sunday morning, wherever it may be, and you know and recognize you have the need, and you know you might feel it, but yet he hadn't addressed or came to the lip or relieve you of that what you might be going through. Maybe it might just need, you know, your mindset change, to be encouraged, or whatever. But because this person, I know God, he can move and do whatever he wants, whatever you bless everybody at the same time or whatever. And it isn't so much to draw attention to yourself for gratification.
Right.
But here I am, Jesus. Hallelujah. Get his attention to move on your behalf. But when you leave church, you want to be changed. You want to know that situation. You want to have that confidence that knowing God is working behind the scenes. Praise God.
Amen.
But anyway, to answer the question, I think to, you know, to get his attention.
Okay, so the Dorothy, you know, the sacrifice, I can't put my hands on it right now. Psalms 51, the sacrifices of God are broken spirit. So when a person gets broken, that's the thing that really gets God's attention. Because usually that's the point that people are very sincere. See, the kingdom of heaven itself is vital, but the vital will take it by what? Force. So let me see if I can find that in Psalms 51. Alright, Psalms 51:17. That's what God really likes. And let's read it all together there. It says what? Sacrifices of God. So a sacrifice of things that we offer up to God, and the sacrifice is something that you offer up to God many times before the blessing comes. So that's the thing that brings God on the scene and draws God's attention and gets God involved in eliminating or meeting that need. It's got to be a sacrifice offering. It's got to be your heart. I mean, you got to pull out your spirit to God. And we find that by shouting out, by praising God, releasing. Miles Monroe said it like this. He says that when you have expended all of the praise that you have on the inside of you, that's the point that God will come in and really show himself strong. When you have gotten all the praise, now he was recommending that you sing, pray in the Spirit, then you dance in the Spirit, then Shabbat, loud, and then worshiping, you know, fall down, and sometimes when you can't shouting out. I remember when I first got filled with the Holy Spirit, about an hour or so, I was just screaming. Lost my voice. And all I could do then was just lay down on the floor prostrate, weeping and crying. That's all I could do. I wept and cried. When I got to past the point where I couldn't get nothing out, my prayer turned to weeping, crying, and agonizing. That's what Miles Monroe said. When you get to the point where you can't do no more, then the music comes in, take you a little higher. Fall down under the anointing, take you a little higher. But ultimately, what you want to do, you want to get to the point where singing in the Spirit becomes spontaneous. How many understand what I'm saying? Singing in the Spirit and psalms and hymns, a little tune, making up songs. And that is the point in the Spirit where God will actually come in and perform supernatural things. Now, let me show you in Jehoshaphat thing, after they Shabbat, after they worshiped the Lord with a loud voice, what happened? Then he appointed singers to go out and to praise the Lord in the beauty of holiness. And as they went out, that's what they were commanded to do. So I imagine they were singing spirit songs. But they started in prayer, then the prophet, the Spirit of God, gave them a word. Is that right? And then the leaders began to what? Worship the Lord. Then the Levites began to what? They began to bow down and praise God real loud. And then the singers started. And after the singers started, evidently the peak in worship that was needed in order for God to be completely released, they flowed into that, tapped into that. And after, you know, everything else was history. God immediately set ambushment. That's the thing that brings God on the scene. When you get to the point where you are completely out of yourself. Amen. How many remember being out of yourself lately? Everybody know what's going on Sunday? Everybody know? We're thoroughly aware of what everything. All right. But I think that we're going to really have to take another look at our worship. Like Sunday, that service, that should have gone another hour. It should have been miracles, it should have been healings, it should have been everything. But some are putting on brakes, and some are trying to get the what? The Spirit to move. And some are put on brakes, oh, it's time to take the offering. Or it's time to what? It's time for Pastor Hill to get up. But we ought to be saying it's time for God to move. Amen. So we just want to get y'all in a realm where y'all can understand that there's a lot more in prayer than praying the same way and in the same tone and in the same intensity all the time. You got to get beyond that and expend a lot more what? Energy. Open up, holler, do something you ain't never done. Amen. And really get to the point where you can just lose sight on yourself and let God, what? Take over and let God do what he wants to do. Amen. I think that we could be some really happy Northsiders. If everybody, amen, begin to what? Focus on ascending in what? Worship. Amen. Let's start ascending in our worship. Get to the point where we can sing. Amen. Sing spontaneously. So that's what I like to do sometimes at 7 o'clock when we start on Monday night. Sometimes I like to start singing. But, sometimes I do it and sometimes I don't. Sometimes you don't do things because people won't understand. People think that I can't do it, so why is he doing it? Amen. All this time singing, I don't know what he's talking about. Amen. We can just go on and we've been going further. So, but I think that we need to understand that there's a lot more of releasing that we can do in worship. And by releasing more, we're going to be able to what? Get God actively involved in whatever we're believing him to do. And it's not going to take a long time to do it. Amen. Some things would take 2 weeks rather than 2 years if you would just move up a little higher in worship. Amen, Pastor Hill.
Amen.
All right. Now, if I'm telling you the truth?
Amen.
All right. How many going to try?
Amen.
Let's go.
All right, now, anybody can relate Paul and Silas? It's another good illustration. Paul and Silas. This is a familiar story. All right, somebody give me the story. Paul and Silas. All right, I guess we can turn there and read it. I guess at least we can do that. That must be around Acts 16. Because how did they get that earthquake to take place? How did they? Man. All right. Acts 16, what verse do we need to start reading? Should we start reading to get the whole picture? Mr. Sarah said, let's just start at midnight. Well, we want to build up to midnight, don't we? All right, that's 16. If we can do the daily devotion for some. All right, let's start with 16. All right? Preachers like to have the wives read.
Okay. Verse 16. And it came to pass, as we went to prayer, a certain damsel possessed with a spirit of divination met us, which brought her master much gain by soothsaying. The same followed Paul and us, and cried, saying, these men are the servants of the Most High God, which show unto us the way of salvation. And this did she many days. But Paul, being grieved, turned and said to the Spirit, I command thee in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of her. And he came out the same hour. And when her master saw that the hope of their gains was gone, they called Paul and Silas and drew them into the marketplace unto the rulers and brought them to the magistrate, saying, these men, being Jews, do exceedingly trouble our city and teach customs which are not lawful for us to receive, neither to observe, being Romans. And the multitudes rose up together against them, and the magistrates rent off their clothes and commanded to beat them. And when they had laid many stripes upon them, they cast them into prison, charging the jailers, to keep them safely, who, having received such a charge, thrust them into the inner prison and made their feet fast in the stocks. And at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises unto God. And the prisoners heard them. And suddenly there was a great earthquake, so that the foundation of the prison were shaken. And immediately all the doors were opened, and every man's bands were loose. And the keeper of the prison awakened out of his sleep, and seeing the prison doors open, he drew out his sword and would have killed himself, supposing that the prisoners had been fled. But Paul cried with a loud voice, saying, do thyself no harm, for we are all here. Then he called for a light and sprang in and came trembling and fell down before Paul and Silas and brought them out and said, sirs, what must I do to be saved? Where do you want me to stop? And they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved in thy house. And they spake unto him the word of the Lord, and to all that were in his house. And he took them the same hour of the night, and washed their stripes, and was baptized, he and all his, straightway. And when he had brought them into his house, he set meat before them, and rejoiced, believing in God with all his house.
Okay, that's good. Okay, now in this story, what give you the understanding, well, let me just say it this way. Okay, where does the sacrifice of Thanksgiving comes in? How was this a sacrifice on the part of Paul and Silas? Why was this such a sacrifice for them to do what they did? Sacrifice of Thanksgiving.
They were in prison.
They were in dire straits, right? They were in a prison. They had been beaten, right? And everybody was mad at them. And they had, what was stocks? Anybody know what stocks? Okay, and they were in prison, and so they were really at a real disadvantage. Okay, now what would the average person would have been doing if they were in Paul and Silas' situation? The average one of us. Rejoicing? Okay, we've been rejoicing? Say again? I mean, our feet not even in those stars. I mean, even been in jail. We still won't do.
Well,
not right away, sister. All right, sister. Yes, mister, not right away. That would have to kind of grow on you a little bit, wouldn't it? Okay, the sacrifice came because you feel, you believe they felt like it?
No, they were sore.
They were sore, bleeding, frustrated, discouraged probably. But yet, at midnight, they made the sacrifice. They determined that they were not going to give in to their circumstances. Now, what did Jonah say in the belly of the whale when it seemed like all of his hope was gone? He was at the depth of the sea, and it seemed like there was no way that he would ever escape from the belly of the whale. And Jonah said that, if I observe
lying
vanities, I'm going to forsake God's mercy. Now, what does that mean, Sister Pearl? You weren't here last week, right?
Yeah.
Okay. If I observe lying vanities.
If I look at the circumstances.
Okay, if I get all wrapped up in my circumstances and give in and submit to my circumstances, I'm going to what?
Forsake God.
I'm going to miss God's mercy. I'm not going to be able to receive God's mercy, God's deliverance. Okay, but Jonah opened up his mouth in the belly of the whale. He said, salvation is of the Lord. You can beat me on that, brother. Just come up and help me on that. Now, this is what he shouted out loud. Salvation is of the Lord.
Salvation is of the Lord.
I got to beat you. Okay, let's do it again. Salvation!
Salvation! Of the Lord!
Alright. Alright, we get somebody's attention before y'all leave.
He's a preacher teacher.
Okay, now, when Jonah opened his mouth and probably screamed to the top of his voice and said, salvation is of the Lord! What did the fish do?
Vomit him out.
What did the fish do?
Vomit him out.
What did the fish do?
Vomit him out.
All right, the Bible says the fish vomited Jonah out of his mouth. And Jonah was a free man. What got him out of the belly of the whale? That sacrifice. So I'm going to sacrifice to the Lord with the voice of thanksgiving. I'm going to pay that I have vowed. Salvation! Woo! I'm getting happy. All right. Salvation is of the Lord. Nothing too shall now lift in your voice, getting excited, releasing yourself completely, pouring out your heart to God. Don't tell me. Ain't nothing to it.
That's the thing that gets God's attention. The sacrifices, that's the thing that got Paul and Silas out of that what? Philippian jail house at midnight, and God has a son of earthquake. Amen. Praise God to shake that place loose. All of the bands fell off and they were all free men. Amen. How in the world can praises be so powerful? The weapons of our warfare are not what? But amen. Now, Sister Dorothy, I told everybody, I said, if you were on Sunday best. They're looking for gospel singers. Go on, put your application in. I don't believe nobody can sing louder than you. I don't believe nobody can open up like that. All right, so it is a blessing to let go and let God have His way. So it's about time for our prayer meetings and our worship service to start changing. I'm tired of dragging, and we come in like we're coming in as spectators. God don't want no spectators and dictators and agitators, and God wants some people that will step up to the plate and worship the Lord in spirit and in truth. All right. Now, I'm going to let you go.
Yeah, in closing. It seems like that in all of these situations, there was a desperation. Jonah was desperate. Mm-hmm. Paul and Silas, Jehoshaphat, and Brother Wayne's a Canaanite woman.
Desperate
situation. So there's a common thread there. Mm-hmm. So the question would be then, are we desperate enough? Are we desperate enough?
How we can create a state of
desperation.
Desperation.
Yeah.
All right. All right, Hill, so y'all write that down.
No, I didn't say that.
How can we create a state of what? Desperation. All right, you got to figure out what you, if you really have a need. If you don't feel no need to do anything, you have to do it.